Well, good morning and welcome to the Justice Committee's 12th meeting of 2016. Agenda item one is the draft budget scrutiny for 2017-18, and it's my pleasure to welcome Caroline Gardner, Auditor General for Scotland, Angela Cullen, Assistant Director, Mark Roberts, Senior Manager, all from Audit Scotland. And we're very pleased to have you before the committee today. I refer members to paper one, which is a note from the clerk, and paper two, which is a SPIFE briefing, along with the written submission, which Audit Scotland has very helpfully provided us. And I understand that you'd like to make an opening statement, Auditor General. Yes, please.
Thank you, Convener, very briefly. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence to inform the committee's pre-budget scrutiny. There are three points I'd like to very briefly highlight for you before we start. First, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service budget has been relatively static in real terms over the last 5 years, reflecting financial constraints across the public sector. In the last 2 years, the Crown Office has received additional financial support from the Scottish Government for specific casework and to reduce the time taken for cases involving domestic abuse to reach the courts. Second, long-term financial sustainability is a central theme in our work at the moment. Due to the financial pressures facing public bodies, we've been encouraging all of them to think about long-term potential future financial scenarios and to develop strategies to deal with these. I'm pleased to say that the Crown Office is now developing a long-term financial strategy. Thirdly, while the Crown Office is constitutionally and operationally independent, it's also obviously an integral part of the justice system. My report last year on the efficiency of the Sheriff Court system noted concerns about how well that system was operating, especially at the local level. Our monitoring suggests that progress has been made since then, with improvements in the operation of local criminal justice boards and the internal restructuring of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. As you said, Convener, I'm accompanied by Angela Cullen, who is the appointed auditor for the Crown Office, and by Mark Roberts, who leads our work across the justice sector. And together we'll do our best to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you very much. That's helpful. Do members have questions? Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the opening remarks. It takes me straight to one of the ones in which I was interested, and that relates to the long-term strategy over 10 years. I just wondered, as the auditor, what factors you think should be being considered in this particular context, because I would suggest my experience, because I've been there doing this sort of thing, that trying to look as far distant as that is extremely difficult. And specifically, are you expecting that as a result of the exercise they're undertaking, that they will identify changes in the law, perhaps, that would help give them stability? Are they anticipating changes in the law, which are not necessarily yet being talked about? Because just to give an example, but not for any particular reason, but just an example, there clearly might be changes in fixed penalties, which would reduce the number that come into the court system at the bottom end. How are they going to deal with these kind of imponderables, and how would you expect to see that documented in what you will subsequently be auditing and engaging with?
It's a very good question, and I'll ask Angela to come in a moment with some of the specifics. I'll maybe preface it, though, by saying the bodies we audit often are anxious at the prospect of doing longer-term financial planning, and we recognise that they only receive their funding, in most instances, in firm figures for a year or so ahead through the Scottish Government's budget. And it's not that we think they can get a financial strategy which is right, in inverted commas. Instead, it's the process of thinking through exactly those sorts of changes, what we know about the likely direction of public finances, and how they would react in different circumstances. I'll ask Angela to talk you through the specific things that she would be expecting to see in her audit work with the Crown Office in future.
Okay, thanks. Really good question, Mr. Stevenson. And we, a few years ago, when we published our report on Scotland's public finances, at that time when we first recommended, or actually probably second or third time we recommended that public bodies develop long-term financial strategies, we set out what we expected to see. And that area wasn't in huge detail, but at high level, the areas that we expected bodies to cover. We absolutely recognise that they don't know their budgets, but they do know their costs. So the costs and the cost drivers, what their priorities are over that period, what some of their savings, and historically they've managed, where they've historically managed to make savings, and different scenarios that they might want to model, different options. So some of that might be legislation that they're aware of that will come in the next few years, and how that might impact on their services and demand for their services. So a whole range of areas that we would expect bodies to be looking at, and the Crown Office are considering that at the moment. They are making progress in this area. What we would also say is that we don't expect those financial strategies to be developed and then put up on a shelf. They should be living documents, and they should be dusted off and refreshed every year or so, when we know what some of the new areas are that are coming in. So new legislation. If it wasn't anticipated originally, and 2 years down the line it was, we would certainly expect that to be built in, and different scenarios and options modelled around that.
Can I say, absolutely, we used the phrase shelfware. So I absolutely recognise what's being said there. Can I just take that a wee bit further and analyse what the purpose of doing this is? Is it to inform government of the needs of this functional area? I guess it will in part be that. Or is it more focused on enabling the organisation to be flexible in its responses by having done some strategic thinking about the consequences of a range of scenarios? And if it is that latter in particular, will that mean that the plan is less about numbers and more about activities?
I would say it's both of those things and a third. Particularly for the Crown Office, we know it is an integral part of the overall justice system. And for example, in our report last year on the Sheriff Courts, we talked about a significant increase in work that had come through because of Police Scotland's focus on traffic offences. So the discussion needs to be with government, within the Crown Office, but also with the Court Service, Police Scotland and other players in there, to make sure that everybody understands and as far as possible is taking a joined up approach to the direction for the justice system. My sense is that the most important focus is within the Crown Office itself. As I say, it gives them the chance to think through the direction of travel for the demand they will have to deal with, how they can manage that demand, and what's likely to happen to their funding. It obviously links to other strategies like the workforce strategy and the digital strategy that Angela has also recommended they should be taking forward for how they would manage that. And I know one of this committee's concerns is whether the Crown Office has sufficient resource to carry out the demands made on it. It will help to identify how far that excess demand could be met by efficiencies within the system, and how far there may be a discussion that needs to be had with government longer term about the resources that are needed to deliver the system as it currently stands. So it plays both of those roles, but having that really detailed understanding of what the pressures are and where the scope is to work differently to meet them, I think is a fundamental starting point for having a sensible discussion about it.
Perhaps finally, before I return the baton to others, this will clearly be something that will engage quite a lot of people in the organisation and take quite a bit of effort and lead to quite a lot of debate perhaps about the organisation. Have you any sense of how many people, how many man-hours might be reasonably thought to be properly applied to this? And therefore, on the other side of the equation, what are the benefits and how will we know we've had any benefits in taking a strategic? I mean, if I say to you, I work for the Bank of Scotland, the Bank of Scotland published its first annual accounts only after it had been in existence for over 250 years. And until we in the computer side started to do strategic planning, did none whatsoever. So I'm familiar with two worlds. And I just wonder, for this quite substantial piece of work that will challenge and so on and so forth, how big is it? But also, where do you expect, when you go back to audit what they've been doing, where do you expect to see the benefits from actually taking this approach? And I guess other parts of government will be listening to your answer as well.
I'll ask Angela to talk about the specifics of the Crown Office, and I might pick up later if there's something to add.
Sure. I get cost of developing, certainly in the, I can't tell you a number off the top of my head how many hours it might take to develop one. In the first instance, it will take more time to develop and involve more people, and we would actively encourage as many people to be involved as possible, because often the people that are on the ground doing the work can identify where efficiencies can be made, so absolutely they should be involved in that. Once it's developed and mainstreaming and keeping it up to date, as I mentioned earlier, should be easier. It certainly should be an activity that's mainstreamed. It should have significant focus and attention. So, sure.
May, if I intervene at this point, these are warm words, but I get no sense of scale from them. So please, can you give me some sense, because you're going to come in and look at the effort that's been deployed in this. What are you, and you're going to make a comment saying you spent too much time or too little time, or the outcome wasn't satisfactory. Have you got your metrics for when you go and audit this activity at a later date that will tell you that this COPFS has successfully taken this request for a 10-year plan forward or not?
So I may or may not comment on how much it's cost them to develop the plan. What I would be looking for is, has the strategy, does it cover all of the bases that we would expect it to? Have some of the assumptions that they've made, do they look reasonable? Are they in line with historical activity and is it predicting future demand? And what I mean by historical activity is, What has been their success rate in delivering efficiency savings to date, or are they being overly optimistic in the early years? Have they built in some areas where it might need upfront investment to actually make changes and deliver savings further down the line? So I would be looking for all of these things and seeing whether the plan, the strategy looks reasonable, rather than necessarily how much it costs to deliver it. But I would expect there to be benefits from it. I would expect it to reduce the cost base, or, as the Auditor General said, allow them to have that discussion with government around, actually, we're now predicting that over the next 5 years, we may need to either stay flat cash or need a slight increase in our resource base to allow us to meet the demand that's coming our way. So I would expect those benefits to be there. I would also expect there to be awareness and ownership throughout the organisation for some of those areas that are in that financial plan, and everyone understand what their role is and identify where savings can be made.
No? Just following up on that, I mean, intuitively, where there is uncertainty, I mean, and the further along that 10-year spectrum, I mean, the more uncertainty there'll be. The kind of human reflex, I would have thought, in an organisation, and COPs will be no different from any other, is to make the case for maintaining as much of what you have as you can, and building in argumentation that supports that, whether it's anticipated changes in legislation or workload pressures brought about through some other mechanism. So the value of the exercise to some extent almost seems to be, this is an opening negotiating position, and once we see the detail of the budget, then we can start kind of scenario planning for, well, look, on that basis we can reduce our activity in these areas, we can perhaps deliver efficiencies there, but what's the upside in offering up those efficiencies, which needless to say ministers will take, will bank, and then perhaps look for other ones if in the event that budgets are even tighter than was perhaps anticipated.
In a sense, I guess the other side of that negotiating, and I'm talking hypothetically, is that we know the government's budgets for most organisations have reduced in cash terms, at least over the last 5 years or so, because of the downward pressure on the block grant coming from Westminster. So the process is a difficult one, as it always is in a time of reducing resources. I think it's one of the reasons why, as Angela said, we'd expect there to be a whole range of scenarios explored and sensitivity analysis applied to them to look at where there may be room for absorbing rising demand within existing resources, working differently to reduce costs in some areas to invest in others. It's also an area where there's an important role for the non-exec involvement in the Crown Office to be asking some of those challenging questions, bringing experience from elsewhere, bringing a fresh pair of eyes about the way things are done. There clearly are incentives that are conflicting and competing in any process of this type. Again, I think it's another reason why having that analysis clearly set out with a range of scenarios, different assumptions, different ways of responding to it is the best way there is in difficult circumstances. That's not to say it's perfect, but it does give you a starting point for exploring what's really happening underneath the surface of the numbers.
You touched on there, obviously, that we are well into a process where, or a period where budgets have been tightening. And I suppose what slightly surprised me from the report you helpfully produced for the committee is in paragraph four, you talk about the recommendation at COPs to develop a long-term financial strategy to inform its development over the next 10 years. I mean, to some extent, given what we've gone through, is there not an argument for saying that this is something they should have been doing, maybe not at the outset of that process, 2008, 2009, but certainly shortly after, that this is something they should have been preparing? And if that's the case, are there other organisations that you're auditing that have gone through that process earlier? And are we seeing sort of benefits as a result of that?
I think it's fair to say that most of the public bodies that I audit have struggled with the concept of longer-term financial planning. They've all had firm financial allocations just for the year ahead in the budget, and sometimes, as I've reported elsewhere, they've had changes to their budget within the year.
So have you made this recommendation before, or has your predecessor made this recommendation before, and it's not been sort of picked up on?
As Angela mentioned in the introduction to her response to Mr. Stevenson, the first piece of work that my predecessor did in, I think, 2010, which was very specifically about responding to, after a decade of growth, what looked like the start of a decade of real pressure on finances. The recommendation in there was about taking a much longer-term view of the finances. That was to the public sector in general, and obviously the Crown Office is an important part of that. I think it's fair to say that many organisations have struggled with what that means. It's not something they're particularly skilled in doing, and they've tended to focus very much on managing the budget within year rather than the longer-term focus on what they're there to achieve. It's also fair to say that Angela's now recommended this in her audit report for 2015-16, and it was part of the discussion in 14-15. And although the work is now underway for the Crown Office, I think we feel it could have been started earlier than it was.
And have you set a sort of time frame for when you would expect to see the first iterations of this? As you say, it's a living document, but when would you expect to see the kind of first flush of this?
So in response to the 15-16 annual audit report that I prepared on the Crown Office, management accepted that recommendation, and their timescale for it was that they would start the process. It was dependent on two issues. One, that they were doing a project called Shaping the Future, which was a sort of restructure within the Crown Office. So that was a piece of work that needed to be completed before they finalised the financial strategy, and also that they would refine it when they knew the outcome of this year's the spending review, which is due this week, actually. Their commitment was that they would have something in place certainly by the end of this year.
Can I ask a general question before I bring some of the others in? Repeatedly we've heard there's an issue about churn, you know, things being delayed perhaps unnecessarily. Is there a cost that can be put for a day in court, if you like, an average kind of cost, to try and quantify just the impact of churn, which is a huge issue we're discovering?
The question of churn was a big issue in the work we published last year on the efficiency of the court system, and I'll ask Mark to talk you through that.
In terms of the being able to put a specific cost in terms of a day in court and that sort of thing, we didn't do the analysis quite in that way, but we did build up a model which estimated that the total costs of churn to the system as a whole, so that affected the Crown Office, the Court Service and police as well, added up to about 10 million during 2014-15. So that was where there were cases which were turning over unnecessarily during the course of that year.
Yeah. So as that increases, can we start to then, does that show up anyway? Where does this really come out in that figure, which I think most people can relate to? We hear about churn, but what does that mean? It's disadvantaging witnesses, it's meaning justice is delayed, but actually there's a financial cost here to be quantified.
Yeah, absolutely. There is a financial cost if individuals who are involved have to attend. It has a wider impact on the economy as well as to the kind of individual public bodies involved and their members of staff who are preparing for a particular trial date, for example. Police officers have to attend as witnesses. Everyone kind of has sort of there is a cost in things not going ahead as planned. So the system as a whole is working very hard to try and reduce that level of churn. And in some of the more recent conversations that we've had, we understand that there's significantly better working across the various justice bodies to try and reduce that level of churn and improve the planning, in particular for trial activity within solemn cases.
And is there any more specific analysis of whether churns, is it particularly in solemn, is it in summary cases, is it a particular type of case, or is it just generally across the board?
I think it's generally across the board and so forth. So obviously it's an area of particular focus for the Courts and Tribunal Service, and I recognise that's not the committee's focus at the moment, but they're looking very closely at that and working very well, I think, with the Crown Office at trying to improve their understanding of it as a system, as well as in terms of their own management of their individual operations.
Yes, as you said, the court system is interlinked, and the feedback we're getting is from fiscals being under pressure, being under-resourced, having too many cases, the preparation isn't there, and some of the vital material might not be there in evidence terms, and that is contributing to the churn. So that's useful information. Rona, followed by Mary.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. My question sort of relates back to the financial planning strategy. The figures show the pattern is that the number of trials goes up and down and fluctuates. And I'm just wondering if you would plan on the upside, or would you plan on a sort of average number? Does that make it difficult for you?
I think for any public body, nobody knows what the future is, clearly. And as Angela was saying, I think what we expect the Crown Office to be doing is to be saying, OK, so if the level of activity continues on the same trend we've seen for the last 5 years, this is what it looks like. If we assume that there may have been a peak because of, for example, historical sexual abuse cases that have been reported that have almost been flushed out of the system and therefore we may see a drop in that, it looks like this. If we assume that actually there are more scandals to come out, as we've seen in football over the last week or so, then it would look like this. And you end up with a sort of a fan pattern of what a worst case scenario, what a best case scenario might look like. Mm-hmm. And that lets you plan not just what the costs would be on the way we currently work, but also if we were to take a different approach across the system, we might be able to do it for a lower cost or faster speed. Mm-hmm. It's not that there's one plan which is going to be the outcome, but it's a way of thinking through what might be coming.
Right, so you'd sort of look at both scenarios then and guess on that.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's fine. Thank you.
Mary, followed by Douglas.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I'd like to ask you a bit more about the digital strategy. It was briefly touched on in a question that my colleague put to you, but I note in paragraph 10 of your report, you comment that the COPFS does not have an agreed digital strategy. And it would seem to me if they're looking at a long-term plan, a digital strategy should be part of that. There's been a lot of work done over the last few years to streamline and join together lots of local services. And I would say that the digital strategy should be part of that. So what impact will the lack of that strategy have on the streamlining process?
You're absolutely right. I think it's important to distinguish between the overall system, mm-hmm. where there is a justice digital strategy agreed between the Scottish Government and the various significant players, and the Crown Office. And I'll ask Angela to pick up where the Crown Office is.
Absolutely, there is the Justice Digital Strategy, and each of the bodies underneath that should have their own digital strategy and how to achieve that, the national one, and also what it means for their own organisation. The development of a digital strategy is something that has been a feature of the audit over the last couple of years, and we've made those recommendations. Absolutely right, it's one of the building blocks of a financial strategy alongside workforce and estates and assets. As I understand it, the Crown Office has a draft digital strategy currently, which should be going to senior management and board within the next few months. So that is quite well progressed, and hopefully will be one of those building blocks that will feed into that financial strategy that I'm expecting to see by the end of the financial year.
Is there an investment required to develop that, or do they have the finances to do that?
So it's been worked on over the last few years. A new director of IT was brought in 2013, and that has been one of his priorities alongside lots of the other digital projects that Crown Office has been working on with other justice organisations to help improve the efficiency of the system.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Douglas, followed by Ben.
Thank you. I want to pick up on a number of the points that other members have already made, just to maybe tease out a bit more information. First of all, on the strategic financial management, do you think it's acceptable for bodies such as the Crown Office and others just to almost ignore your recommendation there?
We obviously do our work to make a difference in the public interest, to make best use of public money. We think in the current financial circumstances, everybody should have a longer-term financial strategy, and we've been recommending it for some time.
But the fact that you've had to recommend it for some time over successive years, yet they are laterally now maybe taking some action, do you think that's acceptable? That's my question.
Angela outlined to you the building blocks that were going into it in terms of the internal restructuring and the broader review of the work that's happening. I think those are things that are important building blocks. Equally, as I said in my opening remarks, we'd have liked to have seen faster progress given the pressure there is on the system.
So what do you go back to the Crown Office and say annually when this isn't achieved?
It's a conversation that will normally take place between Angela as the appointed auditor and the accountable officer, the audit committee of the organisation. We highlight again that we think it's important and why it is. And obviously occasions like this with the Parliament are also an important part of that accountability process.
But it seems a weakness from my point of view then, if you continually go in and repeat these statements, expecting something to be done, yet you have to repeat them annually and annually, and therefore does it diminish what you're saying when you give this advice to bodies such as the Crown Office and they choose not to follow it? And then other organisations will think, well, they tell the Crown Office to do it, the Crown Office don't do it, so we're not going to bother either.
I think that's an accurate representation of the way the audit approach works. We do obviously engage in a dialogue with each of the bodies that we audit. There's a whole range of issues for each of them that we think they should be taking forward. And we do have mechanisms like reporting in public, reporting to the Parliament, where we think there's a particular shortcoming. I'd like to have seen faster progress here. Equally, I don't think it's a major failing in the way that audit works or the way the Crown Office has responded to it.
Well, it does seem quite major in terms of the fact you've been mentioning it for successive years. Indeed, your predecessor was mentioning it to the Crown Office. And I just, you know, I picked up in your response to Liam MacArthur that you're saying it's difficult because of the one-year budgeting, yet you actually say, irrespective of the fact that public bodies' budgets are set annually, they should be doing this. So you're telling them that despite all the problems with annual budgeting, you should be doing this long-term financial management, and it's not happening. And I think the public and politicians look to you, rightly, to highlight these issues, but there's no point just highlighting them, and if they don't do it, you know, it just continues indefinitely.
There's no question I think it's an important recommendation. Angela wanted to add something to my previous answer.
Yeah, I think we, as the Auditor General said, we originally made this recommendation, the previous Auditor General originally made this recommendation back in 2010. And we came back and looked at that again in 2013 to see how the public sector had reacted to that. There had been some progress in some areas, but not across the board. So at that time, what we did was we discussed with public bodies what might help them in developing a long-term financial strategy, because we were hearing a lot that actually we don't know what our budgets are, so we can't do it. And as auditors, we don't really accept that argument, because, as I said, you know your costs, you know you can model different scenarios. So that's when we set out these are the basic elements we would expect to see in a long-term financial strategy. And that was in 2013. So we've then been since then been working with bodies to help them improve and develop these areas, both at a national level and a local level. And as auditors, we do go in and look to see what progress has been made, but we also offer advice where it's necessary and where it's asked for, and we would absolutely encourage, as the Auditor General said, that the non-execs are involved in that, because they're often seeing what's happening in other bodies as well. We have a wealth of experience across the public sector. We can point bodies to others that have developed long-term financial strategies and go and speak to them, see what they did. So we have been doing lots of that. Work has been ongoing over the last year or so at the Crown Office, but it has been very much dependent on shaping the future project. And I accept that they had to complete a piece of work to allow them to inform some of their workforce planning, which would help them then model the numbers that they needed to allow them to work out the costs around that for a financial strategy.
So on a similar theme, and it's to pick up on the point that Mary Fee mentioned about the lack of a digital strategy, you mentioned that, you highlighted that in your report in 14-15.
Yeah.
You did it again in 15-16, therefore it hadn't been done the first time. You've done it again. You're now saying at the end of 2016 there's going to be a proposal put to a board sometime in the future. Is that acceptable? Because you state in your report that without having it, and despite you reminding the Crown Office twice about this, putting it in your report, the Crown Office is at risk of being unable to contribute fully to the delivery of an integrated approach across the justice system. Therefore, is it acceptable that they didn't take on board that recommendation earlier?
So, it's disappointing that the more progress hadn't been made. You're absolutely right, that recommendation had been made twice. Things were happening in the background when we did the work. This year, as part of the 15-16 audit, there was a draft, but it was very much a draft, and we did comment on that there was a draft strategy there, but it was lacking in some areas. We made recommendations, they accepted those and said that areas that they were going to work on in developing the strategy, and that's what I would expect to see in this strategy now.
But can I ask, when that was put in the 2014-15 report by the Auditor General, did you expect that in 2016 we would still be looking at a draft which had to be amended, sounds quite significantly, from what you're saying in December 2016? Is that the timescale you were expecting at the time, or would you expect it to be done a lot quicker?
The management response at the time was it would have been completed before now.
And what do you do when it wasn't? You just write the same in the next year's report?
Well, we continue to work with them behind the scenes on looking at drafts and commenting on them, and does it actually cover the areas we would expect it to cover before they progress it any further.
Although you would expect them to be able to provide you with a draft that Absolutely. Should be acceptable, rather than having to, it's almost as if they rush something out because they realise it's been mentioned twice and they're going to get in trouble if it's mentioned a third time, so they shove out a draft that needs quite a lot of work done to it. That doesn't sound like a strategy that's been developed through rigorous research and a lot of time put into it.
So, I mean, as I said, I would have expected it to be completed before now. Possibly an area that's worth following up with the Crown Office as to why progress hasn't happened to the timescales that they specifically set out.
Can I ask a final question, Convener? On the local criminal justice boards, now you mentioned how they were detailed in your previous report, but from April 2016 they've joined up with to merge in similar terms to the six sheriffdoms that we have in Scotland. Then you go on in your report to this committee to praise the great work they're doing. Is 7 months enough time to really analyse and consider how good the work they are doing? Is that sufficient time to be putting quite strong, positive words in a report to this committee?
As I said in my opening remarks, in the 2015 report we produced, we said that there was good joint working at a national level now, but much more variability at local level. Mark's been monitoring what's been happening since that report was published in 2015, and I'll ask him to talk you through why we've got that impression. It's not based on full audit work, but it is based on monitoring.
So the reason for the original criticism in the 2015 report was a lot of feedback that we'd had through interviews of people saying that at the local level, criminal justice boards had struggled in terms of the aftermath of various organisational restructurings, for example, the establishment of a national police force, the reorganisation of the Crown Office into a federal structure. And a lot of people felt that the relationships which had previously existed at a local level, at local criminal justice board, had broken down. And that contrasted very much with the strong positive joint working that was going on at the national level through the Scottish Government's Justice Board. What we've been doing very recently is just going back to meet some of the key people involved in terms of the original report. So the Crown Agent, Chief Executive of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, and representatives of the Justice Directorate in the Scottish Government to ask what has happened since.
So these are the people that are very happy about it? Because that's understandable. If you ask them, they are naturally going to be very positive about this process. I'm just surprised that now the Auditor General is writing how good things are after just 7 months, because that seems quite a limited audience you've gone to get feedback from.
That's true. That is a limited audience. And as the Auditor General said, this is ongoing monitoring that we're doing at the moment. This is not a comprehensive, fully validated and tested piece of audit work.
Although from a politician's point of view, and I'm not saying there are any issues, but I pick up some things locally that I'm not content with. Yet if I raise any questions, someone will say, well, the Auditor General is very supportive because after 7 months they are writing in about the good working, etc., etc. Yet it turns out that feedback and that analysis is based on quite a small number of people who have clearly got a vested interest in ensuring this work successfully. And I just wondered if that's the type of rigorous approach we would normally take to statements such as this.
So our intention would be to continue to monitor this and follow up with a wider group of stakeholders over a longer period of time. Our monitoring of the impact of our reports is not a kind of one-off event. We're doing it 12, 15 months after publication. I and my colleagues will continue to speak to a wide number of stakeholders to get a kind of full picture of that. This is kind of the feedback that we've had to date, but I recognise the point you're making. So.
It's probably also worth noting that one of the important findings from the report we published in 2015 on the sheriff court system was the extent of variability across different sheriffdoms, some where there were obviously big problems in terms of communication, churn, delays in the system, others that were managing it much better. And one of our recommendations was that there was real scope to learn from the places where it was working well and spread that through. And that's one of the things we think is starting to happen through the local justice boards, with the caveats that Mark set out for you.
Okay. And did you have a supplementary, Stuart, if it's very succinct?
It's fairly succinct. I think the issue has been raised by Douglas Ross perfectly properly, the broader issue of what is auditing. And I just wanted to test your view of that against a view I bring with me. First of all, it's a legal aspect. You have to sign off the accounts. The institution being audited has limited discretion over how accounts are presented and how things are counted up and how they're documented and so on and so forth. But the bigger bit that we've been discussing here is the advice, and that's the word I've constantly heard, quite properly, where you are not the people responsible for running the organisation. The management of an organisation takes your advice, notes your advice, and chooses which parts of it to implement, but is responsible for accounting to you for the choices they make. In other words, you do not instruct them. You point to areas that the management concern. So you take nothing, you cannot be seen as taking anything away from the responsibility of the managers in an organisation. And I just wanted to test whether that is your view. I'm seeing the body language saying yes, but it would be useful to get it in the record.
Couched in terms of the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service, which is specifically what we want to drill down on this morning.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, that's absolutely right. And that arm's length relationship is there for a very important reason. We have to be able to report on the Crown Office independently. There are international standards on auditing that set out very specifically the fact that we cannot take management responsibility at the level of preparing the accounts all the way through to developing a strategy for them. And that's so that we can report on how they're doing without fear or favour. In the context of my role, that reporting happens here to this Parliament, where there are issues of sufficient significance to bring that about. In the case of the Crown Office, we haven't felt the need to do that so far. We have done it for a range of other bodies. I don't think we have any former Public Audit Committee members here, but I regularly report on a body where I think the failings are significant enough to escalate it to Parliament. But under my performance audit powers, reports like this one on the efficiency of the Sheriff Court system are the way of providing that assurance and making recommendations for future improvement. And there are a number in this report that are relevant.
Thank you.
Hey, Ben?
Thank you, Convener. In the same framework that the Convener's questioning was orientated in around efficiency and churn, I was interested in paragraph 3 of your written statement submission that there was a reference to witness costs as part of the further 15% that's detailed. I wondered if there was specific data available on specialist witnesses and how much of a percentage in terms of cost that they occupy in terms of annual budgeting, whether that can be provided today or at a later date is just something that we've been looking at in detail.
Mark?
We don't have that specific breakdown of data in terms of specialist witnesses, but I'm sure the Crown Office might be able to provide that to the committee, so, or alternatively, we can be in touch with them and get back to the committee in writing. So
I'd be grateful for that, thank you.
Yeah. I wonder if I could turn to something that was raised in one of the submissions from the justices of the peace, or one particular justice of the peace, and that was to blame short-term faults on a need to prioritise budgets, and specifically he referred to the costs of the decision to appoint summary sheriffs and referred to a compensation package, also to benefits packages paid to sheriffs. Have we quantified that? Is there a figure you can give the committee today for these costs?
I don't think there's a figure we can give you today, but as Mark said in response to Mr. McPherson's question, we're happy to liaise with the Crown Office to give it to you. I think the broader response is, again, that's why the workforce plan that Angela referred to is so important. I know the committee has heard concerns elsewhere about fiscals depute on short-term contracts, about the training of fiscals. And I think for us, that's why a workforce plan is so important, to have a longer-term view of what the staffing is likely to be for different types of staff, and to make sure that that's being developed in a consistent way rather than a stop-go way.
Yeah. I think this is relevant because there's the issue of fiscal fines, and maybe JPs now just, you know, nodding things through, whereas before they had a much bigger role. And it's pointed out they are volunteers, so in terms of value for money, then that speaks for itself. And if a policy decision has been taken to now appoint summary sheriffs, I think it would be good to quantify that in a monetary term, as well as looking at what this actually means for what they're doing in the court. But you mentioned judicial training. The other issue that was raised in the JP submission was the cost of introducing the Judicial Institute and also the Fines Enforcement Agency. Does Audit Scotland have costs associated with that?
It's not something we've looked at so far. It's clearly something we'll take into account in planning future work in the justice system. May well, but again, be something you want to explore with the Crown Office when they give evidence to you.
Yeah, well, he was quite clear that these were areas where work had been carried out more efficiently under the old system, and the introduction of these new organisations was coming at a cost, which wasn't necessarily making improvements, so it would be very good to quantify that. Liam McArthur.
Just following up the convener's questions, I think you touched on it yourself, Auditor General, in terms of the short-term contracts. I think what we heard in evidence we've received is that actually we're training up people within the Crown Office and Fiscal Service, some very high quality, well-recognised training, and at the point at which almost the return on that investment is about to be realised, they're then being kind of released. As an organisation, is that a sensible approach to be taking, particularly when budgets are under pressure?
We produced a report on workforce planning again across the public sector in 2013, I think, and the purpose behind that again was to take this more strategic view of how any organisation manages its workforce at a time when, on the whole, demand's increasing and finances are reducing. Mm-hmm. And clearly, it's not sensible for any of us to be training people who we don't have a role for in the longer term. The court service, the Crown Office, our own organisation tend to have peaks and troughs, and there is a question about how you manage those peaks and troughs and uncertainty about demand. But I think for any organisation it's really important to have that core of well-qualified, well-trained people who are able to do the job and who are building up the capacity and the confidence to do it in a way that's consistent and in line with the overall objectives the organisation's trying to achieve.
But back to, I suppose, the line of questioning Douglas was taking in other areas. That was a recommendation you were making back in 2013. Certainly all that we've heard through the evidence we've received in this inquiry is that that is very much still the modus operandi in the Crown Office. Not really any indication that's likely to change or is beginning to change. I mean, what steps would you take, having made that recommendation in 2013, recognising that budgets are not going to improve markedly going forward, to see a change in approach that means that the investment going into training is not, in a sense, being squandered by then releasing people to other roles and having so many people on short-term contracts?
As I said in my response to the convener, having a workforce plan is a key part of that, looking at what's likely to happen to activity levels, to different types of staff, to the way they interact with each other and the way the work's organised. We have recommended, both at a national level and specifically for the Crown Office, the importance of a financial strategy, a workforce plan and the digital strategy. We understand that all three of those are in hand, and we'll be looking closely at how quickly they're developed and how comprehensive they are. But as Mr. Stevenson said, it is the Crown Office's role to develop those now.
Absolutely, but your role to keep their feet to the fire,
indeed.
Presumably.
Yeah.
Sorry.
And if I can just add to that, one of the things that we would expect to see as part of that workforce planning, workforce strategy, is the proportion of staff that are expected to be permanent. And there may still be some fixed-term, short-term contracts to see through peaks and such like. So I would expect to see that, the current status and where the organisation wants to be to meet its demand over the next 5 years and how it's going to get there. So if it wants to change the proportion of permanent staff to short-term contract staff, how it's going to achieve that.
A question on another area,
but yes, that's fine.
We were going through the figures before you came in and looking at the budgets for the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service over a period, and there was a change in the way that appeared to be measured, where previously it was under summary and solemn court processes to one which measures staffing costs, etc. Now, I think we could understand why, perhaps from an internal management perspective, that move made sense. But from our perhaps selfish perspective, looking at the work of the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service, it in a sense took us away from some of the kind of information that we're trying to drill down into, where the cost is being borne by the service, and where potentially, if there can be a move away from certain types of trial processes, there could be savings made without diminishing access to justice, etc. I mean, do you have a view on the change that was made? And from an auditing perspective, any comments you could offer?
I'm a member of the tripartite budget process review group set up by the Finance Committee and the Scottish Government to look ahead. And one of the things I think we should be seeking to achieve from that review is more information that links the amount of money we spend with what we get for it. Outputs like the Sheriff and Summary Courts and the outcomes that we're seeking to achieve as well. So in my view, the more information can be comprehensive, easy to use, and linked to performance, the better it is. Mark, is there something you want to say about the specific shift there?
I don't think there's anything specifically, I guess, just that just presents challenges, especially when we're trying to look for long-term trends in terms of tracking budgets, when there is a kind of change in the presentation at the lower level breakdowns in terms of looking at budgets. It does present challenges in tracking shifts in resources.
And as I say, I think we can understand from a management perspective why you would want to go in that direction, but from what you're saying, I don't put words in your mouth, but there doesn't seem to be any reason why that breakdown as it was before can't be provided even alongside the figures around staffing and other cost provisions.
I'd be surprised if that information wasn't available within the Crown Office.
So we'd be, yeah. I mean, we'd be entitled to ask for those trends over the last short while. Good.
Could I ask, you mentioned again in your opening statement about the additional funding provided for certain specific court casework, and then again to, I think, prove the performance data of cases of domestic abuse, and that this was a national priority. The additional funding has been quantified. Have there been any unintended consequences as a result of this policy for the rest of the service?
The policy of reducing the time taken for domestic abuse cases.
And providing additional funding for specific court and casework.
Mark, is there anything you want to say about that?
I don't think I'm aware of any kind of unintended consequences. As I said in response to Mr. Ross's question, we've not done detailed audit work in terms of looking at kind of the performance data. We were particularly interested in the performance involving cases involving domestic abuse, specifically because, as you say, Convener, that was a national priority and there had been additional funding, so that seemed a particular one to focus on. We've not looked more widely at performance, for example, in other types of cases, during that kind of less formal follow-up work that we've been doing recently.
Is that something you intend to do? Because it's the whole case scenario. If one part of the system, if there's a problem there, an unintended consequence, that can cascade down.
In terms of kind of the ongoing monitoring of the sector and certainly looking at how the justice sector as a whole is going to respond to our recommendation about refining its suite of performance indicators. That's certainly something that we'll keep an eye on and monitor. We have no immediate plans to do any formal audit work looking at that in the same vein as the 2015 report, but our programme of work is continually ongoing in terms of what could be included within it.
If I could delve a little bit deeper, even on the domestic abuse, because it's a national priority, we've heard evidence that perhaps cases are continuing when there isn't a sufficiency of evidence to do so. Now, if that's the case, then it's going further into the system, increasing costs as it goes along, and that's not efficient for anyone, it's not delivering a good service, and it's certainly not a good use of what's very precious financial resources. Can you comment on that at all?
I don't think I could quantify or provide really any additional evidence, and I think the Crown Office would be better placed to respond to that sort of question, to see whether they have any data, to see whether there are unintended consequences of that prioritisation, as you described.
Well, clearly it will have a financial implication, that's self-evident, and I would hope Audit Scotland would find a way to drill down to that, because it's pretty germane to the problems that we're hearing about. Can I ask one last question, and that's on, we've heard that fiscals are under huge pressure. The admiration for them is boundless, but they shouldn't have to be coping with this. The stress has been huge. Have you quantified how many days' absence and stress there is in the fiscal service? Because I believe it's pretty daunting.
My recollection, and Angela will correct me, was that the average number of days lost sickness absence in 15-16 was 7.2. Sorry, I'll correct myself. I think it would. I won't.
I think it's
I don't have the figure to hand, but I think it's 10.1 and the Scottish Government average is 7.2.
Right,
so but that's all staff in the Crown Office, not just the fiscals.
Yes, I understand that, but clearly there's a significant rise there, and again, there are financial implications for this, and the knock-on effect in the fiscal service. Are there any figures you can perhaps send the committee on this or present?
The Crown Office is better placed to let you have the figures. It might be useful though just to restate that when we did the work in 2015, we found significant differences across the different sheriffdoms in the way that cases were being managed. Mm-hmm. And I would expect that to be having an impact on the stress levels that staff and particularly fiscals are experiencing. And it would be well worth exploring with the Crown Office what they know about that and whether there are any correlations there.
But you wouldn't be looking at it from the audit point of view and the financial implication of this, which is significant, clearly.
The 2015 report was looking at the overall effect of churn, and Mark's talked you through the figures we brought together there in terms of quantifying the cost of it. The Crown Office does publish its sickness absence rates in its annual report and accounts, and as the auditor, Angela, makes sure that their processes for producing that information are sound. But to us, that's one indication of the pressure on the system, which is the focus of our overall work in this area, and which it's clearly key for the Crown Office to address through its financial strategy, through its workforce plan and the digital strategy.
Yeah, before I've been Fulton in then, are there issues that have been, and I'm sure you've looked to an extent of some of the issues that have been raised during the inquiry, are there issues that have been raised that would make you have a little bit of a reassessment, a review of the areas you've looked at so far and areas which may be productively looked at for the future?
That's a very good question. We were talking before we came in this morning about the questions that had come up for us in reading the official reports of the committee's pre-budget scrutiny so far. I think the one that we don't have an insight into from the work we did in 2015 or through Angela's audit work probably is this question of the consistency of marking and how you get that balance right between having a more standardised approach and having discretion. And clearly there's not a right answer at either end of that spectrum. But it did feel to me in reading the official report that there's something interesting going on in there, in the system as a whole, and probably in specific parts of Scotland.
Okay. Fulton.
Thanks, Convener. It's actually a supplementary to the Convener's earlier point and coming to it from the other angle, if you like. Would you say that the prioritisation of the domestic abuse offences has led to, would you speculate that it's actually led to any efficiencies within the system in those sort of cases? And moving on from that, rather than just asking a second question, rather than it being about domestic abuse cases having an impact on other cases within the system, is there anything that can be learned from that without it having to be a national priority that can be taken into other cases? So sort of seen it supplementary, but coming from the sort of other angle, if you like.
I should start by saying that the legislation that sets up the post of Auditor General specifically precludes me from commenting on the merit of policy. So the fact that it's a government priority is simply a fact, and I have got no role in commenting on that. We will all have a view on the importance of domestic abuse in Scotland's public life. My interest, I think, kicks in when the government has set a priority like that in how well the government and the various bodies in the justice system are planning to respond to it, thinking through what the effect might be on Police Scotland, on the Court Service, on the Crown Office, and what that means for the way that the work is managed between them. I think it would be entirely proper for the committee to ask the Crown Office how it's gone about responding to that. And it's also one of the things that they should be thinking about in terms of their longer-term financial planning, as Mr. Stevenson suggested. What other priorities are there that they would like to be escalating for the future, and how do they make space for that at a time when the overall pattern of crime is pretty steady, but we are seeing some quite significant shifts in its makeup with historic sex abuse, I'm guessing in future more cybercrime. How are they responding to those sorts of pressures? That's at the heart of what they should be doing for their financial planning, their workforce planning, and the way that the overall National Justice Board is looking to manage the system in the interests of Scotland.
That concludes our questions. Can I thank you all very much for attending today? I suspend briefly to allow for a change of witnesses.
Agenda item 2 is evidence session for the Crown Procurator Fiscal Service inquiry. This is our sixth week of evidence taking on this inquiry, and I welcome today's witnesses to the evidence session: Gordon Dalziel, Scotland's representative on the National Executive Committee of the Association of Personal Injury Lawyers, and Patrick Maguire, who is the partner at Thompson Solicitors. I refer members to paper 3, which is a note by the clerk, and to paper 5, a private briefing from Spice, and to the written evidence from both witnesses, which we very much appreciate. And I invite questions from members. John Finney, followed by Mary, followed by Marie, then Stuart.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Thank you very much indeed for your written evidence. Mr. Maguire, it was a comment that you make in your evidence about the COPF treat the prosecution of health and safety crimes more like civil court case than criminal. Can you expand on that and what the manifestations of that approach are in respect of what's very important matters?
Certainly, thank you. This is a practice which I and my firm witness constantly when dealing with these cases. There's nothing, having carried out research and indeed having spoken to various criminal lawyers as well, contained in statute or any form of regulation or law that directs why this particular practice takes place. But in practice, what occurs is that in terms of a prosecution or a health and safety breach where a prosecution is being considered against an organisation, that if that organisation indicates no more than a general indication that they may be willing to plead guilty to any charges that may be brought, then the entire process seems to move into what therefore, because there's no regulation or law underpinning it, an entirely informal process, whereby often very lengthy negotiations take place between the COPFS and the organisation's solicitors. Those negotiations are involved around what the indictment or the charge says. Ultimately, it can come down to the narrative, as it's called, which is a document that finally, if a company does plead guilty, is placed before the court, detailing, often at length, running to 2, 3, 4, or more pages, what has been agreed between them as to what happened. And of course, it's important that that's the very point. It's what was agreed in this course of negotiations between the COPFS and the solicitors representing the company. The net effect... So,
sorry to interrupt you, Mr. McGuire, but isn't plea bargaining part of the system? And if what's different about this, then? Because
The difference about this is the length of time, firstly and foremostly, that is afforded for these negotiations to take place. And secondly, the real practical impact that that has on victims' lives. My own firm statistics show that we as I highlighted in my paper, have been instructed in the last 12 months in relation to in excess of 2,800 work-related matters. That's in the broadest sense, including disease. And my own internal research shows that, in fact, there have only been 11 cases in the last 12 months where there have been any prosecutions. In non-fatal accidents, that's 5, where the average time from crime to guilty plea, in all 11 cases involved guilty pleas, none went to trial, was 3 years and 4 months. And in the fatal cases, that was an average time of 5 years and 3 months. Now, this is not bad cases making poor law. This is pretty representative. There were no outliers in those statistics. So what the practical impact is that victims, and in fatal cases, the families of the victims, have their lives on hold. Things are strung out with very little information coming from the COPFS. And there's another aspect as well, which is that, and there's been two recent examples of this, whereby if things go on too long, it can actually ultimately prevent the prosecution taking place at all. The two examples are the Rose Park disaster, whereby the length of time during which these negotiations took place meant that the company, partnership, as it was able to dissolve, and that meant legally there was no partnership against whom a criminal prosecution could be brought. This was very extensively covered in the press, and then Lord Advocate Frank Mulholland did still try to fight on in the face of that and still try and bring a prosecution forward. But it was always doomed to failure because of the law as it was. That's changed now with an Act of Parliament, but the length of time that these negotiations allowed meant that this company could effectively evade the law. The other example where it sailed very close to the wind, and I refer to this in my paper, is in relation to firefighter Ewan Williamson. This was a matter where eventually there was a period of almost 6 years between fatality and ultimately the guilty plea. What happened during that period, of course, was the transition to the single service. And it was only spotted very late in the day, and only, I have to say, because of the vigilance of the Fire Brigades Union, that it was spotted that that transition legislation didn't contain any provision for the new entity, the single service, being able to be prosecuted for the wrongs of any of the former services. That was plugged just in time for the prosecution to go ahead. But that's to highlight that, yes, there's real human issues about the lengthy time that it takes and the continued trauma that causes, but actually it can have very significant and profound legal implications too in terms of prosecutions going forward.
And can you comment on the nature of your engagement with the Procurator Fiscal Service during that period? And, is there a sufficiency of staff? Is it that there's not enough to be dealing with these? Is it that people don't have sufficient skills? Or what?
I would not question the skills. I think resources and staff is certainly an issue. But as it was described to me by various members of my own firm, and also criminal solicitors I've spoken to who represent both sides when it comes to prosecutions, it's a mindset issue that I am told, and it's described to me, and it's my own experience too, that it is viewed less as a criminal case, like other criminal cases, and more like a civil matter, where you have invariably solicitors representing these companies to defend them are the same solicitors who are instructed by their insurance company to defend what may become a personal injury case. They are solicitors who have a more civil mindset, and that tends to bleed into the attitude and the nature of the negotiations, as they ought properly to be called, with the COPFS, and I think that's really at the heart of the issue.
Our inquiry is about the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service, and I know there'll be wider frustrations about the system. You give the comparator of what happens in relation to an individual driving without insurance for their motor vehicle.
Indeed.
Can you expand on that a bit? You mentioned that in your evidence, please.
Yeah, this is a matter that's also fully covered in the paper by April. It turns on, we have laws which require certain people to have compulsory insurance, and that the failure to have insurance is, by the very nature of not having insurance, a crime. We know how society views drivers who drive without insurance. We know how hard the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service is on bringing prosecutions against those people who they find not to have insurance. In my experience, that attitude doesn't apply to employers who do not have compulsory employer liability insurance. That society, in my experience, don't seem to care, but certainly in terms of the cases I've handled and my firm have been involved in, there's been numerous cases over the years where it's came to light in the course of a personal injury case, where we have taken it upon ourselves with the instructions of our clients to bring it to the attention of the prosecution service, and where absolutely nothing's been done at all, where there's been no prosecutions.
Why has there been no prosecutions, and is that neglect of
duty? I can't answer that question as to why. The facts speak for themselves. I think, again, it's that crime, and it comes to the initial point I make in my paper about the need to be very clear about our language. These are health and safety crimes. They're not infractions, they're not regulatory breaches, they're health and safety crimes. And I'm afraid at the moment I don't think they're necessarily viewed that way.
Okay, thank you very much indeed.
Can I just ask, what would be the consequences of someone not having employment liability insurance for when an incident happens?
It would be a fine.
But what's the consequences for...
For the individual?
Yeah, for the individual who wants to claim compensation.
Yeah, apologies, Chair, I didn't follow the question. The company, if there is employer liability insurance, then an injured worker, if they are able to establish their case, will receive compensation. If there is no insurance, then they may have the opportunity of going against the company if they're solvent. But if they are not, then that injured worker will not receive compensation. And of course, one could speculate, I think, without great criticism, to suggest that if a company isn't doing what it ought to in terms of the law by having compulsory insurance, that they're far less likely to be solvent and able to pay compensation as they ought to.
Mm-hmm. And are there any notable examples of that? Because it isn't something that seems to have penetrated public awareness.
First of all, thank you to the committee for inviting us to speak today. But in the paper submitted by APL, we mentioned two cases, both of which cover the point made by you, convener, in relation to the lack of compulsory insurance. And the effect in both cases was quite significant. First of all, the case of Campbell against Gordon, where a gentleman was injured in the course of his employment. He was an apprentice joiner working on a woodworking machine. Now, for some bizarre reason, his employer had an insurance policy, but it didn't cover working with woodworking machines. And so when he was injured, he attempted to bring a claim against his employer, and the insurers declined to deal with it because the employer wasn't covered by the insurance policy. And so he sought to try and sue the director of the company personally, went all the way to the Supreme Court, and he was unsuccessful. But that was a gentleman left in the position of being unable to claim compensation for a serious injury. The second case in our paper is the case of Kelly Stewart, who tragically lost her partner, who was killed in a diving accident. And again, it's a situation where his employer didn't have employer's liability insurance. His employer was found guilty of a breach of the Health and Safety at Work Act, but a civil claim was raised against him, and albeit a decree was obtained, we've been unable to enforce that decree. Now, when the defender in that case appeared before the Sheriff Court, it was specifically said by the Sheriff that he would not impose a monetary penalty to allow the defender to pay some form of compensation to the family. That's yet to be achieved. Mm-hmm. And so there can be quite significant difficulties for families and for victims of accidents.
Yes, so there's most definitely a case to have these prosecutions as a deterrent to others.
Indeed. Certainly in the case, or in the fatal case I mentioned, we did raise with the Procurator Fiscal Office why they hadn't sought to charge the defender with not having compulsory employer's liability insurance. And the view was that actually it wasn't something that was particularly relevant and wasn't within their mindset. And that comes back to the point that Mr. Finney made. If there was a criticism in relation to mindset, it is the importance of having compulsory insurance for employer's liability. We, as Mr. McGuire says, we have it for road traffic accidents. A lot of work carried out by the Procurator Fiscal Service relates to not having insurance, whether or not there's an accident. So the same approach ought to be taken in relation to employer's liability cases.
Is it a supplementary, Douglas, on this?
Karen, on this point, you mentioned the two cases, Campbell v Peter Gordon and the Graham Mackey incident, and then you go on in your submission to mention a fund of last resort. Could you give a bit more information about that in terms of, you know, levies and such like?
Absolutely. You may be aware of the existence of a body called the Motor Insurers Bureau, which was set up several decades ago, and all insurance companies pay a levy into this to cover people who have been injured in a road traffic accident, but there's been no insurance on the part of the person who caused the accident. And the suggestion is that a similar fund be set up for victims of accidents at work, whereby insurance companies would pay into a similar fund to cover a situation which I've just described in the two cases.
So insurance companies rather than
insurance companies,
the employers.
Yes,
because what you also mentioned in your report or your submission is that it tends to be the ones who are less scrupulous because, you know, if they don't take out this insurance, they won't be doing other things. But they've also got a financial benefit over other companies because they're not paying out for these things.
Indeed.
So by setting up this fund of last resort, does it not almost say, well, we're not going to be able to deal with that problem, so we'll just ignore it? There's only been two convictions, both in the same year, and therefore is setting up the fund of last resort not basically doing the same as what you're suggesting the Crown Office is doing in ignoring this issue and trying to have an alternative source of funding, but not getting to the root problem that the convener was mentioning?
Well, I think it's a combination. I mean, I think there's no reason why the Crown can't be forceful in trying to ensure that the law is complied with. And I think that, and indeed in relation to companies taking out compulsory insurance, there are measures such as, for example, being obliged to lodge a copy of an insurance certificate at the same time as lodging a company return.
Which Although would that wouldn't get you over the issue with Campbell v Peter Gordon, because they would lodge an insurance certificate.
Indeed, and well, I suppose in that situation there could be some investigation in relation to whether that certificate was sufficient. It wasn't in this case, and that's a matter which the Crown would have to investigate. But as a matter of routine, if there were an obligation on a company to lodge a certificate at the same time as lodging a return, then that's a matter that could be easily looked at by either the Crown or by the HSE in relation to reporting companies who fail to do that.
Mr. McGuire.
Thank you. Just to come in the same point, it's important again to draw the analogy from the motor insurance sphere, because I don't think there is any one answer. So what we're talking about ultimately is regulating the behaviour of companies, but at the same time ensuring that victims aren't wronged by bad employers. Now, the fund of last resort provides us an answer to the second point and will ensure that nobody goes without being properly compensated, and I think it is to be commended for that reason, but it's not a solution in itself for the reasons that you've highlighted, Mr. Ross. So that's when you then look at the issue of what is and is not currently publicly acceptable. And we've seen so many examples over the years in terms of road traffic, from seatbelt to drink driving to driving without insurance. The world is just a different place because of high-profile prosecutions, because of high-profile campaigns. And I think we need to address both. If I may also address one issue in terms of competence and the competency of this Parliament, because, of course, we're talking insurance and a fund of last resort, and members of the committee may therefore think that it's something we could recommend but have no power over. It's important to remember that the scheme that Mr. Dale was spoken about, the Motor Insurance Bureau and the fund of last resort, is a contractual arrangement between the Westminster government and the insurance industry. It's my understanding of the Scotland Act that while this Parliament couldn't introduce legislation to enforce there to be a fund of last resort, there's no reason why it couldn't if the insurance industry were willing to enter into such a contractual arrangement.
To Mr. Dale, you say in your submission that latest research from HSE shows that 94.3% of companies required to have insurance do. That's a very specific number, and then you go on to state how many 164,000 employees. If we know it's 94.3% and therefore the remainder don't have insurance, why can't we, or why can't prosecutors go after them?
Right.
Is this an estimate, or is this a reliable figure that drills down to individual companies?
It's based on a report from the Institute of Employment Studies produced for the HSE in 2012, and I can provide a copy of the report to the committee. Interestingly, the figure of 94% is actually a higher estimate. The lower threshold was 81%, because the study was based on a sample of 2,000 businesses who were asked whether or not they had employer's liability insurance, and 94% said that they did. The reason why it may be as low as 81% is that a number of employers, when asked to produce a certificate or refer to its terms, were unable to do so, despite asserting that they had it. And so there was a doubt raised in the minds of the authors of the report that they actually did actually have compulsory insurance. The figure of 160,000 is taken from the same report. It's an estimate, but it's based on a sample of 2,000 employers.
Okay. Mary, followed by Rona.
Thank you. I did have some questions on the insurance, which largely have been answered. But it was just really so, in terms of penalties for employers that are found not to have liability insurance, I mean, you say a lot of them, well, they haven't been charged, but is it just a case then that financial penalties are imposed on them?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. And yeah, just a different line of questioning now. I mean, you talk about in the evidence the very low rates of prosecution. I'd just be interested to hear your opinions on why that is. The numbers do seem to be very low in terms of how many are prosecuted, and yeah, just to hear a bit more from you on that.
I think it's primarily a question of resource. Mm-hmm. And I think that a number of witnesses who have already given evidence to the committee have commented on this. And it's a matter of priority, obviously, for the Crown and indeed for the government. But our position is that employees within the workplace deserve to be protected. If somebody goes out to work in the morning, then they ought to come back in the same condition as when they left. There are a number of situations where very serious breaches of health and safety legislation take place. In a number of cases, there are very serious injuries. In other cases, there are not. But taking the road traffic analogy, we think that those breaches ought to be investigated and assessed for prosecution by the Crown. And we see that in a situation where there are several thousand accidents which are reported each year, and indeed that figure is an underestimate for the reasons that we go into in our evidence, we think that we're only between 50 and 100 cases are prosecuted each year, then we think that's too low. A percentage of 1% of reported accidents being prosecuted is very low.
Yeah, I'd echo that. I think there's little doubt that at the heart of this issue is resources. The vast majority of the employees of the CPOFS that I deal with, particularly the specialist unit, are absolutely committed. The law generally, subject to one matter that we'll return to in a moment, is robust and is there to be used. It's the point I make in my opening paper that the way the very rich tapestry of health and safety regulations that we have in this country are so framed that the vast majority of accidents at work, certainly the vast majority of matters that members of APO and Thompson result in successful personal injury cases, are at the very least prima facie health and safety crimes. So it tells you just how small a number of prosecutions there are each year. That can only be in relation to resources. It is a matter of priority, but when we look at priority, I think the only way that we're going to see accident rates drop to achieve the aim that Mr. DL highlighted and that we would echo 100% is that people have an absolute right to go home from their work in exactly the same physical and mental condition they left that morning, is to address it aggressively and to change attitudes, and that's only by using the criminal law as a deterrence. I mentioned one area where I think the law is lacking, and where I think that can reflect to some extent in prosecution levels, and that's at the absolute highest end. And that is what I referred to in my paper in relation to the law on corporate homicide. We have had an Act of the Westminster Parliament now since 2007. There has not been a single prosecution in Scotland under that legislation. There's no doubt in my mind, and there's no doubt in the mind of every single trade union that I represent in this country, that the law is insufficient, that the law needs to be improved, and that if it was improved, there would be prosecutions for corporate homicide. And that would certainly have the razor-sharp deterrent teeth that we need to see behaviours regulated and changed.
Thank you. I suppose just to follow up, that I suppose that I was wondering if there were any difficulties in providing evidence in some of these cases. I mean, I know that's been an issue for some other organisations that we've spoken to, where, you know, there hasn't been the evidence there to be able to prosecute the cases in terms of like wildlife crime, when we'd spoken to the RSPB and Environment Link about that. Would you say, is that a relevant point here as well, or from your perspective,
Pearson,
how do you find that?
Yes, I think that health and safety law can be quite complicated. One of the reasons that cases take as long as Mr. McGuire was saying in his earlier evidence to Mr. Finney was because you've got complex factual situations. And frankly, the Crown, in many cases, don't have the resource to deal with that quickly. And you know, there's an equality of arms issue. Insurance companies instruct solicitors and experts and will devote a lot of resource to these cases. And there are times when I think the Crown are a bit of a disadvantage. It was interesting actually listening to the evidence from the Auditor General earlier on. I think it was a question from Mr. McPherson in relation to the amount spent on specialist evidence. And that's a matter which I think is worth looking at in the context of these cases, because a lot of the health and safety cases involve expert evidence to a high degree, and it's something which companies who have been prosecuted will, and their insurance companies will, spend a lot of money on defending. And that's an aspect which I wonder if the Crown actually have the requisite resource to match that. And it's one of the reasons why I think so many cases are dealt with by way of a plea bargain, because taking a matter to trial involves a level of resource and a level of time and commitment which, frankly, the Crown aren't able to achieve under current resources.
Yeah, because that was going to be the next question that I had, really, was just, do you think that they have the expertise to be able to deal with these complex cases?
I think they do. I mean, I think there's some very experienced and able practitioners within Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service. It's just the level of expectation and the amount of work that they have to do.
Yeah, I mean, I'd echo that, and I agree that resources, as I've said before, is at the heart of it. That's not to say, however, I think that getting the evidence is a particularly impossible task. I think it's more having the resources to get the evidence, because, as I said, that there is a very complex and well-established set of health and safety regulations in this country that, gratefully, hasn't yet been changed, and that therefore cases can be brought forward, but it's having the time and the resources to build that case. Coming back to some of my discussions with some of my colleagues preparing for this, I spoke to all of our case handlers, referring to a couple of the cases where there were prosecutions and that took, these are non-fatal cases, 2-3 years. On two occasions, the case handler's comment to me was, these are slam dunk cases, that in terms of the regulations, the case handler thought the case was very strong and couldn't understand why it took as long as it did. So I don't think it's the law. I don't think it's the problem of getting evidence per se. I think it's having the people to build that evidence. Now, I accept that in civil law, you only need to prove your case on the balance of probabilities and there's no need for corroboration. So it is a higher standard in terms of criminal law, and well, it ought to be. But I think it would be and should be eminently achievable with the correct resources.
Okay, thank you. Do you still have a supplementary, Mary?
Yes, it's just a very brief supplementary on health and safety. I just wondered your opinion on the resource and support that's available for routine health and safety inspection and monitoring. And I'm not talking about when an incident occurs and the health and safety come out. I'm talking about prior to that. Do you think enough financial support is put into health and safety inspection and monitoring? Is it high enough up the agenda for the majority of workforces, companies, contractors? And is there a direct correlation between increase in incidents and decrease in routine inspections?
In a word, no. I don't think there is anywhere near enough resources. I do not think it's given anywhere near enough priority. And I think there is absolutely no doubt that if more resources were placed into the preemptive, proactive investigations that we're talking about, workplace accidents would reduce. It's been said for a long time that a trade union workplace is a safer workplace, and there are statistics to establish that, and I can produce them if required, but it turns in the fact that in a trade unionised workplace, there is at the very least active health and safety representatives who will be able to bring some pressure to bear on an employer and can even on occasion try and bring it to the attention of the health and safety executive if required. But we have to live in the reality of, as terrible as it is to say it, the economic times that we find ourselves in. I don't think there is going to be found a magic £1 billion to do what's required. That's why in my paper I say that I think it's time to be imaginative about this. I think it's time to look at finding ways in which we can find a legislative means by which we can place more power into the hands of the people who really do know what's going on in workplaces, who are best placed to know that if employers are cutting corners, who are best placed to know if employers care or not about health and safety. That's the workers at the floor level who know what's going on, and therefore finding a way that the remedies that I speak about in my paper, which is to say specific implement, go and do this, or interdict, You Better Stop This are able to be used by workers that if the Health and Safety Executive can't do it, they can, backed, no doubt, by proper trade unions to do that.
OK, thank you.
Rona?
Thank you. I'd like to just return to the issue of delays around plea bargaining and the fact that there's no statutory time limit for bringing health and safety cases to prosecution. Do you think this is like a cultural, historical issue? And I mean, can you suggest any practical ways of the service improving this? And would you like to see a statutory time limit brought in for the prosecution of these cases?
Fair to the Crown Office, in 2009 they set up the Health and Safety Division. And that has had an impact. It's been gradual, and it comes down to a question of resource. I think that the Inspector of Prosecution have carried out a couple of reports, 2013, 2015, and they had made a number of recommendations in the first report, most of which have been acted upon by 2015. I think it comes down to resource. The Inspectorate identified, I think, a workload of about 150 cases, which was seen to be the reasonable level for the division at that time. Put into context, we know that there are several thousand accidents per year. We know that most of those will probably involve some breach of regulations. Not all should go to prosecution, but certainly a number should, and more than the 50 to 100 that currently do. And I think that's where I think the Crown Office recognise the importance of this area. It's just not having the resource to devote to it.
So are you relating resource to staffing levels?
Staffing levels and generally dealing with cases. Mm-hmm. In terms of the time limits, that's a matter really, it'd be interesting to get Crown Office's view on that. Mm-hmm. Some of these cases can be complex. Others can be quite straightforward. And to go back to the motoring analogy, you know, you could have a very straightforward breach of health and safety legislation, and for the purposes of having the deterrent effect, then more of these prosecutions should take place, because at the moment I think most employers and insurance companies know that in the absence of either a fatality or a very serious injury, it is unlikely that they are going to be prosecuted.
Do you think a statutory time limit would make the system more efficient, though, from your point of view?
Without the adequate resource, I'm not convinced. I mean, you've already heard evidence in relation to the pressure on the system, where there are existing time limits in relation to common law crimes and prosecution High Court, Sheriff Court cases. And so by adding additional time limits into the system without the resource, I don't think it necessarily works.
For my part, however, there remains an issue of both perception and engagement, and I think maybe that could be at least partly a solution to the issue that the member's highlighting. Because although things have improved, there's no doubt about that, my experience and the experience of the clients that my firm represents remains the case that for long periods of time they're left in the dark, that there's not sufficiently regular engagement, that they're not sufficiently kept up to date of what's going on, a complete lack of communication. And despite some improvements, we are a significant distance away from where we need to be. And maybe that's where timetabling, in the broadest sense, comes into effect. Not a statutory time frame for bringing a prosecution, but a clear requirement on the COPFS to properly engage with families and victims, and when they're invited to do so, their solicitors too, at pre-arranged timetabled events. And to be clear, to say, well, it's going to be 3 months before we can report back to you, and at month three, make sure they do so. If it's 6 months from then, to tell them that, to keep them informed, to keep them engaged, that would go a long way to if not restoring, certainly ensuring some faith in the system that I don't think is here at the minute because of that lack of engagement.
Okay, thank you.
Douglas, your substantive question.
Could I go back to, it's kind of picking up on Rona Mackay's questions there, but in, Mr. Dale, your submission, you speak about the introduction of a health and safety division within the Crown Office in 2009 being a welcome addition, and you go on to say its remit being to investigate and prosecute all health and safety cases, yet you're both coming here 7 years after that addition with, I presume the same complaints that you had when that was introduced back in 2009. So if it is a welcome addition, why is it not working?
Resource.
So,
I think that we carried out a FOI request, and Crown Office indicated they'd received something between 150 and 200 reports from the Health and Safety Executive and local authorities each year, of which they prosecute something between 27 and 37-38%. Now, as I mentioned earlier on, I think there are many, many accidents that take place each year which are a breach of the regulations and which may well should be prosecuted.
So what was happening prior, or what wasn't happening prior to 2009 that is happening now, or have we got the same problems? Because we've had a number of witnesses come to us to say this introduction of this new specialist unit within the Crown Office has helped, yet they still have the same concerns. And my worry is, if we keep seeing resources a problem and we set up these units, this one's now been established for 7 years, but doesn't seem to be getting to the root of the problems that you're still experiencing and your clients are still experiencing. So is it the units? Is it the manpower within it? Is it the Crown Office in general? Where are the delays? Is it because I just struggle to understand why this can be such a welcome addition when we've still got the same problems? That's the point I'm trying to get at.
It's a welcome addition because you're introducing an element of specialisation.
But it's not solving your issues in terms of the number of prosecutions.
It needs additional resource.
So that in itself is a welcome addition, but it's not working.
But, I mean, from my perspective, to be frank, the bar was so low pre-2009 that, of course, it was a welcome addition. It also, however, it is entirely logical that if you're going to bring together a team of prosecutors who will specialise in only health and safety crimes and will prosecute only those crimes, with that specialism has to bring an improved understanding, and therefore you'd expect a better level of prosecution. But it's important to remember it's from the bar being so low. So I entirely agree, Mr. Ross, that more needs to be done. It is undoubtedly, you ask, is it, what do we mean by resources? Unquestionably, manpower is a big issue within that. I wouldn't be quite as absolutely enthusiastic as Mr. DL and say that it's only about resources, though. I've highlighted on a couple of occasions now that from my perspective and the perspective of the clients that we represent, that there does remain to be an issue with, I hesitate to say attitude because it's bordering on pejorative, but it's certainly the means by which the unit engage with clients and their modus operandi for doing so. For me, there continues to be a real problem there that needs to be addressed, perhaps in the way that I had some dialogue with Mrs. McKay.
Could I move on to another issue, which is, Mr. McGuire, you mentioned earlier on about the lack of information or the little information that goes to and fro the Crown Office. And one of our written submissions to this inquiry is from the Jim Clark rally, which happened several years ago. In their submission, they say there were 60 police officers taking information. There was video footage of the incident, yet still they're waiting for information. And not just a report and a final response, but letters from the chairman of that organisation to the Lord Advocate going unanswered. And, you know, that's one example we've seen in our evidence. Is that repeated across your sector? Do you see that as a theme in terms of this lack of correspondence, but particularly at the highest level, if people feel they have to go to the Lord Advocate and he's not even responding, and the delays which then occur, and the lack of criminal investigations that can take place while we're waiting for those responses?
I mean, the Jim Clark example is obviously at the extreme end, but it's entirely representative, I think, of my firm's experience in the general, as I said, modus operandi of the specialist unit.
Just on that point, you say it's at the extreme end, therefore it is one that's very well known. It's been raised in this Parliament a number of times by my colleague John Lamont, yet still, even with all that backing, they're not getting anywhere with the Lord Advocate. So I can imagine one man and his solicitor is having even more trouble. Yep. And I think for that to be the case in such a high-profile incident is worrying for the general health and safety sector.
I'd agree entirely.
Okay. Finally, can I ask, Mr. McGuire, in your submission you were speaking about the language and you think there's a problem with the language we use. Yet you finished off by saying we have to be careful with what we say and how we say it, but you don't offer any alternatives. I just wonder what, in your view, is the language we should be using?
I think, as I think I did say, we call them what they are. They are health and safety crimes. They're not breaches of regulations. They're not infractions. These are crimes. These are crimes that cause real damage to real people. They have to be treated as such, and we have to gear our entire system towards proper levels of prosecution, proper levels of fines, that it will serve as a real deterrent. That's what the law has to do in this context, to serve as a deterrent to ensure that workplace accidents go down.
And where do you see changing the attitudes and the language in terms of priorities to addressing the concerns you both raised in your submissions? Is it something we should be tackling as a priority, or is it something that will come naturally if there is more prosecutions and successful prosecutions?
The overall principle must be prevention is better than cure, and the proper investigation and the appropriate prosecution of and Patrick's right, crimes or breaches of the regulations is an important element of that. And I think that to enforce the message to employers across the country that breaches of these regulations will be treated as crimes and prosecuted in the appropriate circumstances.
I'd agree, and I don't think it is an aside to bring into this much misused malign term, health and safety. I mean, that's really what we're dealing with at one end of the extreme. We have people belittling and making a joke of this rich tapestry of regulations that are there to protect people, to keep people safe and to ensure that they do return home from work in the same physical and mental condition they did. How do you tackle that? Absolutely using the correct language is key to that. So is it a priority? 100%. And it's actually something that can be done, I think, very, very quickly and hopefully effectively.
Just before we leave that, you've mentioned the Jim Clark motor rally as an extreme end, but equally in the submission from the Office of Rail and Road, they've mentioned that England and Wales, the average time is 12 months from start to conclusion of a prosecution, whereas in Scotland it's 35 months. Perhaps if that figure was sort of more dwelled on or highlighted more, it might put the whole problem in perspective a little bit more. Mary?
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to ask a very quick question about delays in prosecutions. Is, in your opinion, the main reason for the delays lack of evidence? Is it a different burden of proof in relation to prosecuting health and safety cases? Or are there loopholes that allow organisations, individuals, to get through the process without being prosecuted?
The main thing is that the burden of proof is the same. It's, the Crown have to prove the case beyond reasonable doubt. Mm-hmm. I think one of the issues is that, for the reasons we've already discussed, it tends to be the more serious cases that are being investigated. And as a result, that can be matters of complex fact and evidence. There is a culture of negotiation between the Crown and the defence. And I think some of the figures which were suggested in the inspectorate report say that up to, I think, 92% of cases are resolved by way of a plea bargain. Very few cases go to trial. One of the observations they made in the original report was that relatively few fiscals had experience of running health and safety trials. And I think that there's a culture in these cases which are dealt with by the Health and Safety Division for a plea to be agreed, and that takes time. The Crown have to investigate, they have to get their own expert evidence. The defence are well briefed, they're well resourced, and are able to, if not persuade the Crown to drop the case completely, then come to what they would regard as being an acceptable plea.
And has that got something to do with, I suppose it kind of comes back to the point, Mr. Maguire, that you made about people talk about health and safety and the way that health and safety is viewed. And we've moved to a compensation culture, so health and safety is not viewed as a crime. It's viewed as how much money can I get for, and how much of an impact has that had?
Yeah, I agree entirely. I would, of course, say that version of health and safety is also the stuff of spin. But you know, leaving that aside, there's absolutely no doubt that that's had an impact. It's interesting as well that it will invariably be the solicitors who are instructed by the organisation's insurance company to have an eye, at least one eye, on any possible compensation claim coming down the line, who'll be engaging in this form of informal negotiation, and that therefore, actually, what those negotiations are about is as much about having an eye on the possible compensation claim and trying to mitigate against that as it is actually about the criminal prosecution, because actually they know they're eventually going to play out, to use the Americanism, and they're simply using the process far less about reducing the fine, far less about reducing guilty or not. It's about what that charge says, what that narrative says, and whether or not compensation lawyers can latch upon that or not. That's invariably my experience when you start to look at what the charge is, what's been taken out of the charge, what are those one or two wee things that have been picked away? It's unquestionably with an eye on the compensation process. And so to come back to the question about, is it only about the negotiation? I don't know if it's only about that, but that certainly is a significant factor in the lengthy time that it takes. And if there's one thing that can come out of this in terms of something that will make a big difference in terms of driving things forward, it's dealing with that and finding a way by which the COPFS can be driven forward and not look upon it as a civil negotiation, but as we said, dealing with a crime that's got to be prosecuted principally about deterring future injuries.
Can I just make a point following on that, please? Can I just refute any suggestion that we have a compensation culture? There was a report carried out by Sheriff Principal James Taylor a few years ago looking at expenses and funding in civil litigation. And indeed, it's a matter which will probably come to this committee in the course of the next few months. But in that report, Sheriff Principal Taylor explicitly found that there was no evidence of any compensation culture in Scotland. He raised the possibility, he doubted it in England and Wales, but certainly in Scotland, there is no evidence to support that. It is a myth that is put out to support certain points of view on the part of the insurance industry. And it's interesting, in the context of workplace accidents, you are aware from our paper that there are between 6,000 and 7,000 reported accidents each year. The true figure in terms of industrial accidents is much higher than that. But a figure to bear in mind is that there are only 4,000 or so industrial accident claims intimated in the course of each year, and around 1,500 to 1,600 actual workplace cases raised in court each year. So if you take the analogy of a pyramid, you've got the number of accidents at the very bottom, you've got the accidents that are actually reported, you then have the number of cases that go ahead to a claim, and at the very top, the numbers that go into court. So it's a decreasing number. So I think that there is clear evidence to suggest that in Scotland, there is no compensation culture.
Okay, thank you for that clarification.
Fulton.
Thanks. One of the things that this inquiry has certainly done for me, even coming from a criminal justice background, is has highlighted the vast scope of the COPFS and the pressures that are on them, and in particularly with the current resources and these times of austerity, which is well documented. And for what it's worth, I do believe the health and safety crimes should be treated robustly and prosecuted where necessary. But I wanted to actually ask your view on a wider issue. You've mentioned a few times about somebody going to work and returning in the same physical and mental state. I think it's important that, coming from a social work background, and I've worked in a busy social work office for 12 years and seen lots of friends and colleagues over the years go off with various degrees of what you would maybe refer to more as mental or emotional stresses. How wide do you think the health and safety issue should be made? Because I'm thinking this would be massive resource implications if it was. I know I still get the impression that we're mainly in the main. I know you've mentioned sort of mental well-being as well, but in the main, I'm still getting the impression it's more about somebody that's maybe been injured as such or whatever, which should be, as I'll say again, dealt with robustly. But how wide do you think this should be, and what role should just the COPFS have in that?
We make the point in our paper about the economic impact of accidents at work, and the Health and Safety Executive have carried out a lot of research. They produce an annual report looking at the financial impact on society, and I think the figure we mention in our report is the cost to the UK is about 4.9 billion and to Scotland 541 million. Those were figures for 2013-14. The 14-15 figures have just been released, and the cost is still about £490 million, but that to Scotland each year. But that's only in terms of workplace accidents. There's an additional cost, which is far higher, in respect of those people who are absent from work through ill health, but through stress, through having mental health difficulties, and just I think the kind of thing that you're alluding to, Mr. McGregor. And so, in that situation, you know, it's a significant effect on our economy and on our society. Another figure to look at is the HSE estimate that annually 16,000 people across the UK are permanently withdrawn from the labour market due to accidents at work or ill health. So, in Scottish terms, you're looking at probably about between 1,500 and 2,000 people each year.
The final question really is, are the witnesses, both of you, aware of the Scottish work-related deaths protocol? We've received one submission from the Action for a Safe and Accountable People's NHS, that this isn't being used properly, that there are a multitude of consequences, including a loss of important evidence. Are you aware of the protocol, and do you have any experience of it in operation?
No.
Neither.
No.
Okay. Thank you for that. That concludes our questioning. Thank you very much, both of you, for attending. We'll now move on to the next item on the agenda, which is the Criminal Finances Bill, LCM. Before we do, I'll suspend briefly to allow the witnesses to leave. We're just about ready. The third item on our agenda today is to agree on our approach to the Criminal Finances Bill Legislative Consent Memorandum. Is that right? Yeah. And in particular to agree a call for evidence on the LCM. I refer members to paper 4, which is a paper from the clerk, which proposes that we hear in the first instance from the Cabinet Secretary on the LCM before reporting to Parliament. And more specifically, I refer members to paragraph 26 and 27 of this paper, and that refers to a call for evidence as set out in Annex B, page 5. Are
we agreed that we should A, have a call for evidence, and B, that we should hear from the Cabinet Secretary. Stuart Stevenson, followed by John Finney.
Thank you very much. I hope this is not thought to be a big point, but looking at the paper that we have, in particular at page 11, where it makes reference to... sorry, I've just temporarily lost UWOs. Oh, yes, unexplained wealth orders. That's what it is, that can be made overseas. I just wondered whether that hinted at reciprocal arrangements overseas to do so here. Now, of course, I do so wearing a selfish hat, since all the members of this committee are politically exposed persons, and just therefore whether in the draft call of evidence that might be a factor. I'm not pushing for it. I'm only posing the question.
We can make inquiries and it can arise in the evidence session if it's relevant. I'm
happy to delegate any action arising from that to the committee convener. I'm not.
Point noted, and we'll look into that further. Any other, John?
Thank you, convener. Convener, I note that at paragraph 24 and page 9, there's reference made to the consultation that Scottish Government officials have taken place with. It does seem to be entirely with groups who would be very unlikely to knock back additional powers. I just wonder, yes, I think we should have a call for evidence, and yes, I think we should hear from the Cabinet Secretary, but I wonder if we can specifically seek the views of the Scottish Human Rights Commission on this, because I think there are significant potential issues around collateral damage, particularly with regard to residential properties.
I'll turn you over to Peter rather than me doing it by proxy.
Yes, that point is noted. We've got a list of consultees, a standard list of consultees, which covers a full range of people involved in the justice sphere, including third sector organisations and the likes of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. Also think about bodies that might have an interest in this that aren't on our list.
Okay, many thanks indeed.
With that assurance, are we happy to issue a call for evidence and to invite the Cabinet Secretary?
Agreed, yeah.
Thank you for that. Moving on to agenda item number 4, the Justice Committee on Policing. This is to consider a report back from the convener of the Justice Subcommittee on Policing on the meeting held on the 8th of December. This update on the subcommittee will be a regular item on the committee agenda to ensure that all committee members are kept fully informed of the subcommittee's work. Following the verbal report from convener Mary Fee, there will be an opportunity for brief comments and questions, and if there is any specific areas of work which the justice want to consider, this can be looked at in terms of our consideration of the work programme at a future meeting. Now, Douglas, before I hand over...
If I can, before, so it's not a reflection on anything Mary Fee will say, because I'm sure it will be a perfect update, but in terms of preparing for a committee meeting, it's easier if there is a paper to read, and therefore I'm sure it will be a full update we get, but I wondered in future if we can have a paper with the issues discussed. I know we can all read the official report from those meetings, but a summary of the discussions, the points raised and action points, so we are, those of us not in the subcommittee, are prepared prior to hearing a verbal update, because sometimes it's easier to read it, to prepare questions rather than just listening and having questions off the hoof after that. Mm-hmm.
I'm sure Mary's already got something that can go in written form, and yes, that would be helpful in advance.
Thank you.
Mary, can I ask you to give the verbal update?
Thank you, convener, and I appreciate the opportunity to update the Justice Committee on the work of the Subcommittee on Policing. The Subcommittee up to date has taken financial planning evidence from Police Scotland, the SPA, the Scottish Police Federation, the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents, and from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. And we will report our findings in a letter to the Justice Committee for consideration at next week's meeting. The Cabinet Secretary, Michael Matheson, has given evidence to the subcommittee about his policing priorities, which will help to inform our work programme discussion on the 12th of January.
Are there any questions on that? There's a letter forthcoming next week,
yes,
which will have more detail on it, and we can have further consideration when you've got something
in writing before you.
Yes.
Everyone agreed? That's good. Well, I think the only other thing that I have on today's business is to remind members that our final meeting of 2016 is on 20th of December, and we'll be taking evidence on the draft budget from the Lord Advocate and continuing our evidence taken on the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Inquiry by hearing from HM Inspector of Prosecutions. And also at that meeting, we'll be discussing the committee's EU engagement. So with that, I now formally close this meeting.